This is part of being in the will of God. In the will of God, it's not that everything falls down in front of you and you just walk on water all the time. No, being in the will of God means that you face obstacles and difficulties. And sometimes God whispers something into your heart and it does not seem logical. And as you learn to discern the mind of God and the will of God, follow it through. If it's not right, He'll stop it. If it's right, He'll take you through.
When you're up against a struggle that shatters all your dreams, and your hopes have been cruelly crushed by Satan's manifested schemes, and you feel the urge within you to submit to earthly fears, don't let the faith you're standing in seem to disappear. Praise the Lord. Satan is a liar, and he wants to make us think that we are paupers when he knows himself we're children of the King. So lift up the mighty shield of faith, for the battle must be won. We know that Jesus Christ is arisen, so the work's already done. Praise the Lord.
On today's program, Charles Price continues the series, Living in the Will of God. Rather than asking, what is the will of God for my life? We should be asking, how does the role and purpose of my life conform to the general will of God? This week is entitled, Reading Our Circumstances.
Now, if you have your Bible with you, I'm going to read from Acts chapter 20. And I'm going to read, first of all, from verse 22. The setting is that Paul is on his return leg to Jerusalem after his third missionary journey, and he calls in the port city of Miletus, that's where his boat docks, and he invites the leaders of the church in Ephesus, which he founded earlier, to come down and meet with him. And he says some very straight things to them. But in verse 22, where we come in midway through his speech to them, he says, "And now, compelled by the Spirit, I'm going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me, if only I may finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the gospel of God's grace." And in verse 4, chapter 21, it says, "Finding the disciples there, we stayed with them 7 days, and through the Spirit, they urged Paul not to go on to Jerusalem." And in verse 10, "After we'd been there a number of days, a prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. Coming over to us, he took Paul's belt, tied his own hands and feet with it, and said, 'The Holy Spirit says in this way the Jews of Jerusalem will bind the owner of this belt and will hand him over to the Gentiles.' When we heard this, we and the people there pleaded with Paul not to go up to Jerusalem. Then Paul answered, 'Why are you weeping and breaking my heart? I am ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus.' When he would not be dissuaded, we gave up and said, 'The Lord's will be done.'" Now, keep your Bible open at that passage. We've been talking for a number of weeks about living in the will of God. I took a few weeks to look at the big picture with you as to what the will of God includes. And then the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about the issues of personal guidance. And what we've talked about, I want to phrase as questions. First question, what is my vision from God? And you may remember we based that on Paul's statement to King Agrippa in Acts 26, when he gave his story of meeting Jesus on the Damascus Road, how his life was changed. He was given insight into what his life would consist of. And he says to King Agrippa, "I was not disobedient to the vision from heaven." We talked about having a vision from heaven. We looked at other folks in the Bible who similarly had a sense of direction given to them by God. Last week, we asked the question, what do the scriptures say? We looked at David's statements in Psalm 119. "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." He also wrote, "Direct my footsteps according to your word." And we will never find the will of God outside of our regular reading of the word of God, because the word of God is the primary means by which we understand the will of God, and we live within the general will of God revealed in his word if we're going to experience the specific will of God that he has for us personally and individually. Now today, I want to ask you another question. What do my circumstances say? In other words, in discerning the will of God, what role do my circumstances have in helping to clarify and determine what it is that God's will and purpose my life is? And I've chosen to read this rather extraordinary story here in Acts chapter 20 and chapter 21, where Paul is on his way home from his third missionary journey. He calls into Miletus, he meets the Ephesian elders there, and he tells them unambiguously, "Compelled by the Spirit, I'm going to Jerusalem." This is not a whim or a fancy of his own. This comes from the Spirit. It is compelling. I understand it. I know it. And I'm going to Jerusalem for one reason. The Spirit of God is compelling me to do so. Well, that's in chapter 20. That's all well and good. But coming into chapter 21, he arrives at Tyre a little while later. And there, finding the disciples, we stayed with them 7 days. And through the Spirit, they urge Paul not to go to Jerusalem. This also is not a whim of the believers in Tyre. This was not some protective instinct that is being drawn out where they say, "Paul, don't go to Jerusalem because you're going to face hardships there." It says specifically, through the Spirit, they urge Paul not to go to Jerusalem. Now, here's the dilemma. Compelled by the Spirit, I'm going to Jerusalem. Through the Spirit, they urge him not to go to Jerusalem. Paul is undeterred by that. He ignores the warning. He goes down the coast to Caesarea, and it's in Caesarea that this prophet Agabus, who is a prophet who occurs earlier in the book of Acts as well, comes to Paul in Caesarea, taking Paul's belt. He tied his hands with it and his feet with it and said, "The Holy Spirit says, in this way, the Jews of Jerusalem will bind the owner of this belt and will hand him over to the Gentiles." And then Luke adds this little comment. Luke writes the book of Acts. He says, "When we heard this, we," that is the team traveling with Paul, that included Luke, "we and the people there," that is the Christian believers in Caesarea, "pleaded with Paul not to go to Jerusalem." In other words, his whole team of friends and folks in Caesarea unite unanimously, "Paul, do not go to Jerusalem. You're going to get into trouble when you get there. You're going to be bound and imprisoned." And Paul said, "I'm not interested in your opposition to this. I'm ready to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus." And so he insists on going, and they came to an agreement they had together, and the agreement was simply this: the Lord's will be done. But Paul, you're stubborn. You think this is the will of God. We are protective of you. We discern that is the will of God. But whatever happens, we're going to entrust you to the will of God. Now, here's a very interesting dilemma when it comes to guidance and knowing the will of God. And Paul went up to Jerusalem, and he ran slap into trouble. He was arrested. The details we won't talk about. All began with Christian believers in Jerusalem falsely circulating rumors about Paul. He was detained in Jerusalem initially, then he was taken down to Caesarea, which was the Roman capital of Judea. He was kept in prison for 2 years. At the end of 2 years, he appealed to Caesar in Rome because he was a Roman citizen. He had the right to appeal to the highest court, which was Caesar himself. He was shipped to Rome. He had to change boats several times. The boat sank once. He ended up spending the whole winter in Malta. So Rand figures the best part of a year getting to Rome. When he got to Rome, Caesar wasn't interested in talking to him. And the book of Acts finishes very anticlimactically with Paul, the great hero of so many of the chapters, spending 2 years in prison in Rome, and it closes with any indication what happened to him after that. 5 years in round figures, 2 years in Caesarea, 2 years in Rome, best part of a year on the way to Rome. 5 years of seeming wasted life. He had a driving vision, compelled by the Spirit, "I'm going to Jerusalem." To Paul, it was consistent with the word of God to take the gospel into the world as he had been told to do. Then in Tyre, through the Spirit, equally godly men persuaded him not to go to Jerusalem. He does not receive their unanimous advice. He goes down to Caesarea. They equally unanimously tell him he should not go, but he does, runs into trouble. There's some interesting dynamics here. And as you and I seek to discern the will of God, reading our circumstances can be one of the most difficult things in the world to do. And I want to tell you honestly, and I'll point this out at the end, that when I began preparing this message a few days ago, my expectation of where this message would go is actually almost the reverse of where it had to go as I studied what the scripture says about this. And I'll show you why. You see, we need to learn to read our circumstances wisely. In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6, it says this: "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, he will direct your paths." The assumption there is this: that as you acknowledge him in all your ways and God directs your paths and you trust him with all your heart, you're going to discover, you're going to fly in the face again and again of your own understanding, your own human wisdom. You see, if people leaned on their own understanding, Much of our Bible would have to be emptied of some of its key stories. Noah would never have built an ark if he leaned on his own understanding. Abraham would never have left Ur of the Chaldeans, not knowing where he was going, not knowing why he was going, not knowing what he was going to do when he got there. He would never have left had he leant on his own understanding. You know, sometimes, and I want to show you this morning, that as God leads us, again and again, he doesn't lead us around obstacles. He leads us to obstacles. And in those obstacles, we are tested, we are strengthened, we are tried. And I want to use Paul as an example of that. We can be motivated by vision. We can live consistent with the word of God. And yet our circumstances fly in the face of that vision. And then when that happens, we've got some hard deciding to do. What am I going to do? Ian Thomas said to me many years ago when I was a young man, something which I found tremendously helpful. He said, never ask as your first question about anything, is it possible? Ask as your first question, is it right? He said to me, a thing doesn't have to be possible. It just has to be right. Possible things are not always right. Right things don't always seem possible. But if we live in the realm of the possible, we live in the realm everybody on the street lives. That the Christian is called to live in the realm of what is right. And sometimes what is right defies natural understanding. Of course, there are some ways in which we look at our circumstances and there is an obvious message to us. For instance, if I suddenly had this fantastic desire to be an opera singer, there's nothing unbiblical about singing like that. So I'm okay. That's my vision. The Bible's okay. But all I have to do to discover that that is not God's calling in my life is to stand up and sing. And I won't demonstrate what would happen if I did. Obviously, there's some circumstances which say, no, you yourself are not the right person for this because these are not your gifts, your abilities, your temperament, whatever is needed. But what you do when you have a vision that is compelling, you believe it is from God, you've consciously and conscientiously spent time in the Word of God, and the Spirit of God has confirmed this to you, and yet it flies in the face of reason and logic and even of possibility. Well, in that spirit of obedience to God and dependence on God, I'm not talking about our own agendas now. I'm talking about agendas that come from God, obedience to God and dependence on God. I want to suggest three key responses that I trust may be helpful to you and that we can learn from this story and other stories in the Bible. First of all, I'd say be waiting. Don't be in a hurry. Be watching. Keep your eyes open and be willing. Let it go any way that it goes. Be waiting, be watching, be willing. First of all, be waiting. You know, sometimes we have a sense of direction from God and we don't know for sure, then we wait. You know, when Saul of Tarsus was converted on the Damascus Road, he was given this vision, which he said to King Agrippa, he had not disobeyed, that he would preach to the Gentiles. It says that straight away he began to speak in Damascus, so he began to act straight away. But then he went back home to Tarsus. Tarsus is up in today's Turkey. That's where he came from. And it's hard to reconstruct exactly how long he was there. He went down for about 3 years into Arabia first, by the way, spent time in the desert. Then he went back up to Tarsus and he got a job as a tent maker. His training was as a Pharisee. He'd trained in Jewish theology. Now he left that behind. He began to become a tent maker. And it was at least 12 years later, it's difficult to be sure of the timing, but at least 12 years later, Barnabas, who had met him when he was a new Christian and who liked him, was in Antioch leading the church there. So I need somebody to help me. I'll go to Tarsus and see if I can find Saul, which he did, brought him back to Antioch. And Saul worked with him for a year in Antioch. Now, he had to wait for 12 years. And all he did was go back home and make tents. waiting. He knew what God had told him about the big picture. You're going to preach to Gentiles. You're going to be in prison. You're going to face kings and governors. But he waited. There's a great story in Jeremiah 32. Read it sometime later. I'll just tell you what it is. But it's a great story for this reason. Jeremiah says, "The word of the Lord came to me, saying, your cousin Hanamel will come and ask you to buy a field at Anathoth." Now, the significance of that is that Jeremiah is telling everybody that Babylon is going to take us into captivity, part of the judgment of God on us as a nation. They were at this point already heading down towards Jerusalem and Judea, and everybody is now fearful of what may happen. And the point is, your cousin's going to offer to sell you a field at Anathoth. Buy it. Of course, you don't buy something that's going to become occupied territory a few weeks later, because then it'll be worthless. Buy it, keep the deeds, and one day you'll come back and own it. And you're sending a message out to the people that there's a future beyond the captivity in Babylon. So Jeremiah said, okay. And then it says a little later in that chapter, verse 8, "Just as the Lord had said, my cousin Hanamel came to me in the courtyard of the guard and said, buy my field at Anathoth in the territory of Benjamin, since it's your right to redeem it and possess it, to buy it for yourself." In other words, the cousin came and said exactly what God had told Jeremiah he would say. And then it says, intriguingly, Jeremiah says, "Then I knew that this was the word of the Lord." Now, the New International Version is the only translation, as far as I can see, it doesn't put the word "then." But every other translation rightly says, "Then I knew this was the word of the Lord." So what did Jeremiah mean earlier when he says, "The word of the Lord came to me saying, your cousin Hanamel will come and ask you to buy a field at Anathoth"? What he's saying is there's some instinct, there's some sense, there's some impression that's put onto him that this is what is going to happen. And when it came to pass, then I knew this had been from God. And sometimes there is a sense of direction. There's sometimes a pull, and you're not 100% sure. This certainly has been true in my life. And then in the course of time, the circumstances fall into place. You say, now I know that this was a word from God. And there are many times when God speaks and you have to wait. Abraham was told by God, you're going to have a son from the son will come a nation. This nation is going to be a source of blessing the world. And he waited 25 years before that son was born. God told him this. He was already an older man, had to wait 25 years. In the meantime, he did blow it because he couldn't wait any longer, and he produced a son through the maid Hagar. Moses, at the age of 40, we're told, knew that God would use him to bring the Israelites out of Egypt, but nothing happened for another 40 years. And sometimes there's a long wait. Paul waited at least 12 years before he began to take the gospel to the Gentile world, as they've been told to do. And there's a saying some of you have heard before, God's delays are not God's denials. But allow God to delay, because God is never in a hurry. We're in a hurry, of course. We live in this urgent, instant age. Everything is instant in our day. We want to get all done now, if not yesterday. But actually, God doesn't operate that way. And sometimes we have to wait, and we wait until things begin to fall into place. There's a verse I've quoted to you a number of times in Isaiah 5, verse 19, where God speaks about woe to those. And there's a whole list of woes. And this one says, woe to those who say, let God hurry. Let him hasten his work that we may see it. Let it approach. Let the plan of the Holy One of Israel come so that we may know it. So Isaiah 5, 19. Woe to those who say, let God hurry. We want to see it. No, God is never in a hurry. So I remember one thing. It was 3 years between the time God whispered something into my heart that I sensed was from God until it came to pass. Another occasion, something that I felt and believed. I waited 11 years until some circumstances began to happen that made this come to fruition. On another occasion, one that lasted 14 years from the time God put something into my heart, and you waited and waited and waited, and there's nothing. That's okay. Just forget about it. Get on with life. But 14 years later, this thing came to pass, and I knew it was right because of what had happened 14 years before. And many of you will have experiences like that. I know God leads us differently, but you will learn to recognize the pattern of God's leading in your own life. So when God leads you, wait. When you sense something and he speaks to you, wait. Other times, of course, you obey. In this case, when Paul is on his journey and they say, through the Spirit, they tell him not to go to Jerusalem. Well, he can't just sit in Tyre and do nothing. He's already on the journey, so there's no time to wait. Just keep going and you trust God for the consequences. He didn't have 14 years to hang around waiting to see. He needed to just keep going. And sometimes, of course, you're already in a situation and you keep going within that. But here's the first key word, be waiting. Don't be in a hurry. Give God time. Second key word, be watching. Don't wait with your eyes shut. Keep your eyes open to see what's going on. See, Paul had a clear plan as to what he would do after he got back to Jerusalem. On his journey back to Jerusalem, he wrote his letter to the Romans, which is part of our New Testament. And amongst other things, he said to them that there is now no more place for me to work in these regions. This is in Romans 15, verse 23 onwards. And since I've been longing for many years to see you, that is, the Christians in Rome, I plan to do so when I go to Spain. I hope to visit you while passing through and to have you assist me on my journey there after I've enjoyed your company for a while. Now, however, I'm on my way to Jerusalem in the service of the saints there. So here's my agenda, says Paul. I'm going to Jerusalem. I'm going to be in service to the believers there. Then I'm going to Spain. That's my next sphere of operation. I've been looking at a map. Halfway between here and Spain is Rome. I'm going to call in, visit you. I've never been to Rome. I'm going to spend some time with you, and then I'll move on to Spain. That was his plan. But as far as we know, he never got to Spain. Maybe later after the New Testament or the Acts closes, he might have done. But he got to Jerusalem and he's arrested. He's thrown to prison. He spends 5 years. And the story goes off the rails as far as Paul is concerned. Not only that, but while he was imprisoned, I am sure that many of the Christians said, we knew this would happen. We told him he's so stubborn, you know, serves you right, Paul. And when he wrote to the Philippians, he said to them, actually, most of the believers have stopped talking to me and communicating with me, except you folks in Philippi. Most of them around the Mediterranean world, the church, you know, Paul, the fool, he went to Jerusalem, he was warned not to, he got arrested, he's in prison, forget about him. But while he was in prison, of course, he wrote four letters, the letter to the Ephesians, to the Philippians, to the Colossians, and the letter to Philemon. And it's interesting when you read those letters to pick out the references he makes to his prison experience. And in Philippians chapter 1 and verse 12, he says, I want you to know, brothers, that what's happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. Well, that isn't what they were expecting. They thought what happened to him has actually stopped the advance of the gospel through Paul, because he's not fulfilled what he expected to do. So what has happened has really served to advance the gospel. As a result, it's become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else, I'm in chains for Christ. He said, you know, the amazing thing is, I've been locked up in this prison in Rome for 2 years and chained, he says. And the result is the whole palace guard has heard the gospel. You know, they probably chained him to a couple of soldiers, maybe on 8-hour shifts, I don't know. And I can imagine when they chained him up, Paul would say, hi, what's your name? Have you ever heard of Jesus of Nazareth? You haven't? Never even heard of Nazareth? Okay, hold on. Hi, what's your name? Mine's Paul, what's your name? Have you ever heard of Jesus of Nazareth? You haven't? How long you guys chained to me? 8 hours? That's great. I got a fantastic story. Just come as close as you can. I'll tell you. The end of 8 hours, they're unhooked. Next ship comes on. Hi, what's your name? You ever heard of Jesus Nazareth? You haven't? Hold on. What about you? You ever heard of Jesus Nazareth? No? Well, look, I've been talking for 8 hours. I'll sleep for the next four. Wake me up after 4 hours. I got a fantastic story. You won't want to miss it. 4 hours will be enough. Wake me up in 4 hours' time. And these folks will go home and sit around the dinner table, and the wife and the kids say, well, how was your day in the prison today? Well, it was fantastic. I was chained to an interesting guy called Paul, Saul of Tarsus, and he told me a fantastic story. And the kids say, what's the story, Dad? Well, it's a story about a man who was born in a stable. Can you believe it? But he became an incredible miracle worker in Judea. Wow, what did he do? Well, he turned water into wine. That's nothing, though. I mean, he fed 5,000 people, 5 loaves, 2 fish. That's nothing. He healed people who've been sick all their lives. That's nothing. He raised the dead. You can say, wow, that's fantastic. What happened to him? That's the sad bit. They crucified him. Oh, no. Yeah. But that's not the end of the story. 3 days later, he was raised again from the dead. And you know what Paul is telling me? He's alive right now. And you can say, wow, well, how can we know more about this? And so Paul writes to the Philippians and says, hey, don't worry about me. Yeah, I know my whole itinerary got thrown out of the window. I'm not going to Spain. I am in Rome, but not meeting with the Christians like I thought. I'm in prison. Now, he was for some time under house arrest in Rome, where he did receive local people. But when he wrote this, he was in prison. And he says, but the whole palace guard know about the gospel. Not only that, at the end of that, end of Philippians, in chapter 4, verse 22, he says, all the saints send you greetings, especially those who belong to Caesar's household. Caesar's household? Yeah. How come there's a church in Caesar's household? Oh, because Paul's in Caesar's prison, that's why. And Paul has been leading these people to Christ, and of all places in the world, in the hottest seat of authority anywhere in the world, Caesar's household in Rome, Paul says, is a church. And they send you greetings. You see, Paul had a clear plan. I'm going to go to Jerusalem. From there, I'm going to visit you in Rome. I'm going to go on to Spain. But let me say this, and I want you to understand it with wisdom, not just understand this wisely. Never be committed to the plan. Only be committed to God. I could tell you stories in the Bible of people who committed themselves to the will of God, but they detached it from God himself. Abraham is one. God's will for him was he'd have a son. After 10 years, there was no son. So he committed himself to the will of God, had a son through the maid Hagar, who was fertile. His wife Sarah had not been. And why did Abraham produce Ishmael? Was that of rebellion? No. Abraham produced Ishmael out of a sincere attempt to do the will of God. Don't commit yourself to the will of God. Commit yourself to God, and you see his will as the direction, but it's a compass, not a map. Move in this direction, and as you do so, let God alter it, do what he wants to do, because what he is doing is probably quite different to what you expected he might do. And again, the plans go off track, but be waiting and be watching. Don't waste your time in prison getting bitter about the fact that you were imprisoned in the first place. Don't waste your time in prison becoming embittered by the fact that it was Christians in Jerusalem who started the rumors that led to Paul's arrest, that he was anti-Moses, which he wasn't. You know, sometimes things go wrong and we get hurt by the fact things go wrong. We either respond humbly before God and say, God, this was not in my schedule. It's not what I wanted. It's not what I planned, but I thank you. Nothing takes you by surprise. I trust you in this. Or you can become angry. You can become bitter. And I know Christian people for whom in their hearts has come this bitter root, because when plans changed, when things went wrong, when the unexpected happened, instead of responding to it graciously and understanding God in his wonderful wisdom and sovereignty is working out some other purpose here, they respond with anger because of the frustration of it, because of the pain of it, and they become bitter. And I've seen it happen again and again. And it's a hard root, this root of bitterness, to deal with. So be waiting. It's God's agenda. And God could entrust Paul with this because Paul was able to say, by the way, earlier in chapter 20, he said in verse 24, I consider my life worth nothing to me, if only I may finish the race. In other words, says Paul, my life means nothing to me. So if my life means nothing to me, it doesn't matter if I live or die. It doesn't matter if I'm free or in prison. The only problem comes when your life does matter to you. And it's a liberating point to come to say, Lord, I want no agenda but yours in my life. And if I die this week, I die this week with a smile on my face. I'm happy to die this week because that is under your purposes, okay. If I'm not where I wanted to be next week, that's okay. If the role I play no longer, that's okay. Because my security, my meaning, my purpose is not wrapped up in what I do, not wrapped up in where I am. It's wrapped up only in the purposes of God. So my life means nothing to me. That's why it was no big issue when they said, Paul, don't go to Jerusalem. You're going to get into trouble. No big issue to say, no, we'll go because my life's worth nothing to me. And later in chapter 21, he says in verse 13, why are you weeping and breaking my heart? I'm ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem. the name of the Lord Jesus. Hey, don't worry about me being bound up in Jerusalem, which is what Agabus had told him. I'm happy to die in Jerusalem if it's for the name of the Lord Jesus, for his purposes, for his plans. You know, it's a liberating, liberating way to live. And it's not pie in the sky. This is real Christian living. So be waiting, be watching, keep your eyes open. Thirdly, be willing. Be willing to allow God to put you in his place at his time, however different that may be. It seems to me in chapter 21 that when the believers in Tyre through the Spirit urged Paul not to go to Jerusalem, it seems to me the Spirit seems to be giving Paul an option. Now, you may have a different view of this, and that's okay. But trying to weigh up the various possible explanations for being compelled by the Spirit on the one hand and through the Spirit being told not to go to Jerusalem on the other hand, it seems that the Spirit of God is saying, yes, I want you to go to Jerusalem, but Paul, I'll never frog march you there. I'm giving you an option, a way out. And when God guides us and leads us again and again, you find that he gives us good reasons not to follow. He tests us. When I began to prepare this last week, I thought it'd be good to look at how circumstances are agents in guidance, and they are. My expectation was that I would conclude this message by showing you how that God causes good things that encourage us, that reaffirm, keep us on track. But as I studied the scriptures to prepare this message, I couldn't find those stories. I found stories where God would guide and bang, they'd run into a wall. And God would seem to guide and they'd hit something that was totally illogical. Or all the advice would be, no, don't do it. I thought, isn't this an interesting pattern? Because again and again, just having all your circumstances fall into place is probably not a very reliable way to discern the will of God. Because the will of God is so significant and so important that again and again, you'll pay a price and it'll toughen you, it'll strengthen you. That's why in the New Testament, suffering, opposition, persecution is again and again evidence of the will of God. 1 Peter 4, verse 19 says, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. Those who are doing the will of God are going to face suffering, hardships. Philippians 1, 29, it's been granted to you on behalf of Christ not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, seeing as you're going through the same struggle you saw I had and now hear that I still have. This is part of being in the will of God. In the will of God, it's not that everything falls down in front of you and you just walk on water all the time. No, being in the will of God means that you face obstacles and difficulties. And sometimes God whispers something into your heart and it does not seem logical. And as you learn to discern the mind of God and the will of God, follow it through. If it's not right, he'll stop it. But if it's right, he'll take you through. Joseph, as a young man, had a dream. You remember we talked about him a few weeks ago. And he dreamed two dreams. And the message of those dreams was that his brothers all bowed down to him. He told his brothers. He believed those dreams. His brothers didn't like it. They got rid of him. And instead of his brothers bowing down to him, they act arrogantly, wanted to kill him. Instead, they sold him as a slave, made some money off him, went into Egypt, sold on the market. That's humiliating. Bought by Potiphar, his wife tried to seduce him. She made false accusations about him. He's thrown into prison. Everything for Joseph goes wrong. But 22 years later, you remember, he is prime minister preparing for the years of famine. And 2 years into the famine, his brothers came to buy food. They were brought to Joseph, not knowing who he was. He didn't know who they were until they walked in and came down to ask him for food. He recognized them. They came down. They bowed down in front of him. And Joseph knew this. 22 years ago, I had this dream. Whatever's happening now is right on target, is exactly the will of God. We didn't know for 22 years. You went to Joseph in prison and said, Joseph, you know, God spoke to you when you're a young man and gave you a great vision. Yeah, that wasn't a vision, that was a nightmare. That's never going to happen. My brothers treated me so badly. But wait. Watch. And just be willing. I get invitations to speak in different parts of the world. And I take some of them, most I'm not able to take. One day I received an email from Australia, somebody I'd never met. He lived in a town about a two-hour flight from the city of Sydney on the edge of the outback area of Australia. He was a local physician, medical doctor in that particular small town. He said, I'm writing to you because there are a number of us in this town who are concerned about the spiritual life of this town and the spiritual life of the churches. We would like to organize a weekend. We have a long weekend where Monday is a holiday. We'd like to organize an event on Friday night, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday, where we invite people from different churches to come together to study the Word of God. Would you be willing to come and speak? I have absolutely no idea how many people come. Probably not a lot. There's not a lot of us here in this town. But he said that some of them had used some of our DVDs in a Bible study. But we'd like you to come if you could. Well, normally, a letter like that, I would say, thanks for the invitation, but I'm sorry, I'm not able to come. It's too far. I wouldn't say this, but the reason too far, it's a bit unpredictable. It's not a lot of people. But as I read that letter, I felt I'm not going to reply. So I stuck it away. And waited. And then I got another letter from him saying, did you get my first email? We'd love a reply. So I wrote back and I said, you know, for a strange reason, I think I should come. I don't know what the reason is, but I think I should come. When I arrived there, it's about 3-4 years ago. When I arrived there, he met me off the plane. And we went for lunch, he and his wife, we went for lunch. And he said, you know, we have some difficulties. There's been some opposition to this event. And he said that the pastor of the biggest evangelical church heard a couple weeks ago that you do not believe in the deity of Christ. Which, of course, is nonsense because everybody's worried. Of course, I believe in the deity of Christ. But he had heard a tape of a message I'd given in Spain, of all places, on Philippians 2. And in Philippians 2, it talks about how that Jesus made himself nothing. Though he was co-equal with the Father, made himself nothing. I talked about what that nothingness meant. How that Jesus said, I myself can do nothing. And then he said, the Father in me does the work. And that Jesus lived as a real human being in dependence on his Father. And I liken that to what real humanity is. So I was talking about the humanity of Christ. But of course, I believe in the deity of Christ. I'd stated in that message that Jesus was never less than God. But he lived on earth as though he was never more than a man. Anyway, they said, this has caused some controversy. And this man announced the last two Sundays to his people, they should not participate in this event. And they would not announce it, they did not advertise it. Though, of course, he was advertising by saying, don't come to it. In fact, he made it interesting by saying, don't come to it. In fact, people came because he said, don't come to it. Anyway, the point is, the first night, it was not many. I can't remember, 50, 60, 70 people. Saturday morning, Saturday afternoon, Saturday night, Sunday in a church, Sunday night, we had a big crowd, several hundred. Monday, we had less. And from every human point of view, you would say, well, was that really a good investment of time? And on the Sunday night, a man came to me and he said, I understand you have a TV program from the People's Church. I said, yes, we do. He said, I work for a television station. We're looking for good Christian material. Could you send me some samples? So I came home, I got a Living Truth folks to send some samples. And within 3 months, we were on television nationwide, as we are twice a week in Australia. They then pass it over to New Zealand, and now we're on 3 times a week all across New Zealand. The point I'm making is simply this, that the invitation was to go and speak to a handful of people in New South Wales. God's agenda was that we could teach the Word of God to thousands of Australians and New Zealanders every week. That's what came out of it. I didn't know that, of course. And I would have been embarrassed if somebody said to me the week before I went to Australia, what are you going to do there? Well, I'm going to speak in a little town. What kind of meetings are they? Well, local guy is planning them. How many are going to be there? I don't know, 50, 60. You're going all the way to Australia for that. I would have been a little bit embarrassed. And I couldn't convince you, yeah, this is the will of God. I'm never certain something's the will of God. I don't think any of us are certain till we're maybe 90% sure and step out and we look back, or 80%, you look back in retrospect, then you're sure. You step out in faith. But you see, the will of God is not just everything opens up and falls into place and everything's hunky-dory and it's all nice and all the walls fall down as you get close to them and all doors swing open. Sometimes you've got to bang on the doors. I know there's a verse I've said before, an open door. That's a great verse. That's not the definitive verse on guidance. Sometimes you have to push. If you're looking for direction from God, and if you're a Christian, of course you are, because fundamental to being a Christian is your life is not your own anymore. It's over to Him to lead and guide, use you for His glory. And if you're looking to God for direction, what is the vision that's in your heart? Are you spending time in the Word of God, which is a light to your feet, lamp to your path? God guides us through His Word. What do your circumstances say? And sometimes your circumstances say there are barriers that are humanly impossible. Unless God breaks down this barrier, we are going nowhere. Well, that's a wonderful position to be in. Wonderful position to be in. Because when God breaks it down, there's that reassurance. You know, Paul told us in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, and I finish with this. Talks about presenting your body as a living sacrifice in verse 1. And then he says in verse 2, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Now, when I speak about that verse, I love the good, pleasing, and perfect will. But don't forget, then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is. You have to test it, and it'll test you. You'll be tested in your pursuit of the will of God. Not only is the devil out to outwit you and take you off track, of course he is, but the Lord himself will give you that fantastic catch of fish at the worst time, because now you think, oh boy, I should stay and look after the fish. And actually, that's when you leave. Well, we're going to pick this up next week and look at another issue that I think is a factor in God guiding us. You may be in a situation, circumstances are not working well, but deep in your heart you sense God is leading me in a certain direction, a certain way. We walk by faith, not by sight. Sometimes we cannot see, but don't do anything foolish or rash. Wait, watch, and be willing. And He will guide you. He's committed to guiding you. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that as we look into your word, we find consistency of truth. We find in people's lives and experiences, although everybody's different and every story is different, there are issues that keep cropping up. Teach us the patterns of your ways and the patterns of your workings. And I pray, Lord Jesus, for those who may be here this morning and you've tucked something into their heart. It's alive, but doesn't look at all possible or even reasonable. If this is from you, Lord Jesus, make that flame in their heart burn more brightly, more strongly in conviction, but give them the patience to wait your time, whether it's 3 years, 12 years, 25 years, whatever it may be. Thank you, in your own time, you'll bring to pass. And we have the privilege of living in the center of your will. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation. Tune in again next week for another message from Charles Price, Seeking Good Advice. In life, we constantly have to make important decisions. So how do we discern the will of God for our lives?
The first question needs to be, what is the will of God? Period. If we ask as our first question, what is the will of God for my life? The focal point, the central point, is me. But if the question is, what is the will of God? The starting point and the focal point is, what is God doing that is bigger than me, of which I may be a part?
There is no set formula for discerning the will of God, but the Bible does give us some guidelines. This 9-part series, Living in the Will of God, will point you in the right direction and help you avoid some of the pitfalls. Write to Living Truth to order by mail or call Canada +1 416 222 3341, extension 113, or contact us through our website, livingtruth.ca.
Can't take.